Hi there, my name is Sergiu and today I will be talking to you about improving the block I/O compatibility in bhyve. For starters, I am a student at the University Polytechnica of Bucharest. I'm in my final year of master's and I'm very passionate about system security and systems in general. I'm also a sysadmin at the university and a sysadmin for the CERN site that is located at the university. So I have a bit of a sysadmin background to this work. And for a bit of context for this work concerns bhyve, which is a type 2 hypervisor that is included in the FreeBSD operating system. And at the moment, you can only run virtual machines with bhyve from raw disks. This means that your virtual machine will only be able to run from disks that actually look like physical disks. And this has many drawbacks, as I will show you. And recently, for the bhyve project, we have merged the save and restore feature. So this means that your virtual machine will be able to save its state and resume it at a later time. And this is very important work that has been merged in other hypervisors as well, and we expect that it will have a big impact in the future. So the current issues with using raw disks is that most other hypervisors don't actually use raw disks. These hypervisors use specific implementations for each of the hypervisors. So for example, QEMU KVM uses QCAL2, VirtualBox uses their own format, VMware uses VMDK, and if somebody wants to transfer their VM over from that hypervisor to bhyve, they won't be able to because we do not recognize those files. They'll have to convert those files, and this makes the whole transition more difficult for the person wanting to do it. Furthermore, the raw transmission with the raw file, the raw disk file, are called sparse files. These sparse files actually look like, if you want to use a 40 gig disk, it looks like it occupies 40 gigs of disk space, but in fact it occupies less, but it doesn't. The drawback for this is that when you want to copy this disk file and you're not paying attention to it, you're actually going to be copying 40 gigs of data, even if you have 3 gigs of data physically on the disk, and this is a big drawback. And furthermore, the issue with bhyve at the moment is that even if you want to add another file, disk image format, you wouldn't be able to because the raw disk format is hard-coded inside of the code. So you have to basically hard-code another type of disk image, and that isn't a pleasant thing to do with code. We regularly want to have code that is modular and that lets us extend it easily. So the objectives that I had 1.5 years ago was adding more disk types to bhyve, and specifically adding the QCAL2 disk type, because this would help us with adding snapshot support. So if you don't know, QCAL2 has support for saving the state of the disk that you're using. And this is very helpful, as you can imagine, when actually wanting to save the whole state of the virtual machine. And that is very important for the save and restore feature for bhyve that we've been implementing. And as I've been saying, most other hypervisors actually use QCAL2 at the moment, and many cloud platforms also use QCAL2. For example, in the Polytechnica University of Bucharest, where I work and I study, we use OpenStack, okay? And all of the disks that we have on our storage are actually QCAL2 disk images. Why we do that? Because it saves us on storage, and they're easy to extend because of the snapshotting feature. You only need to have one original disk, and then the snapshots will be just the differentials of the disks, and that is very cost effective when it comes to disk space. So for adding support for multiple disks, we are using libvdsk. So libvdsk or libvdisk is the work by Marcel Molinar, and this adds the and it's basically a library that aims to collect implementations written in C for many different disk types such as VMDK, QCow, VHDX, and so on and so forth. But this library has never been pushed upstream. But the cool thing with it is that it fits perfectly with the Bhyve code. And let's look at how it would fit into Bhyve. So let's say that we get a block request from the guest. So this IO request comes from the guest to the host. The host then it goes through the block device implementation, be it virtio block or PCI-AHCI, and this layer encapsulates it in a block request and sends it to the block interface subsystem. In this subsystem, the block request is added to work queue, and this work queue actually has many worker threads that dequeue each request, and this request then the worker thread with this request calls a libvdsk call from the API, and this call further down the line will call the qcow2 implementation of if we're using a qcow2 disk, or a raw implementation if we're using a raw disk. So you can see that by adding libvdisk, we're actually we're actually adding an abstraction layer to the work. And let's take each component step by step. So first of all, in Bhyve we have the block device emulation, where we have emulated different types of disks. So NVMe, AHCI, or we're using the actual virtio block. And the block device driver actually does a block interface open in order to initiate the threads that I've been talking about earlier, and this is the part of the code that actually does the wrapping of the guest requests to block requests. And the block interface layer is like a bit of a single point of failure, as this is the part of the hypervisor that actually handles the requests. So this is where all the block threads, the block worker threads, do the work, and this is where we call our libvdisk functions. And these functions are, some of the functions are actually here. So we're looking at stuff like vdisk open, read, write, flush, and so on. These are all an interface that is provided by the library. This is the external API that we are calling. And what was earlier implemented in the Bhyve code has just been moved inside of the libvdisk internals. So what we did is, when you call a vdisk read with a raw disk image, you're actually going to go you're going to have two new steps in your calls. So you're going to have two more calls, but the underlying code that you're going to be using for the raw disk image is the same that is now in Bhyve. Internally, each disk image is wrapped inside of a vdisk format. This vdisk format enables us to have the affirmation abstraction, because when I want to implement, for example, the qcow2 disk, all I have to do is define the function pointer for the kubectl, right? And that is going to be called when the block interface subsystem calls the vdiskread or the vdiskwrite. So this is very easy to extend further with other disk formats, even this stuff like network disk images. So this is a pretty easy way to abstract the internal sublivy disk. And now let's go to some other work, to the kubectl2 implementation. So as I've explained earlier, kubectl2 is an image file format that has been first integrated into Kimo, and it has some nice features that make it very useful for us. So the first one and the most critical one is the usage of snapshots. So snapshots mean that you can save the state of the disk at one moment, and after that, when you want to use the disk again, you use the snapshot file, and when you want to do a read from the snapshot file, it will be read from the root disk, and when you want to do a write, or you want to change something in the original disk, you do it in the snapshot file. This enables us to use the disk more efficiently, because now we, instead of having, for example, if you want to snapshot a VM, have two disks, one for the original virtual machine and one for the snapshot, now you have one disk and one differential. Another good thing about kubectl is that in the Kimo implementation, it has good performance, it has a lot of caching, and a lot of thought has been put into this disk image format. It also has compression support and encryption support, and it's a really nice image to use, and it has a lot of support for very many tools. So for example converting disk images from one type to another, and it's implemented in a bunch of places, so we have a lot of reference implementations for it. And it's really useful for the save and restore feature, as I've demonstrated before. So let's actually look at the kubectl2 internals. Kubectl2 uses a header file for a header block for where the flags and the features that you're going to be using with it. And it has a two-layer page table-like internal structure. So how this looks like is it's very similar to the virtual memory mechanism that we have in our kernel, in the operating system. So all of the data and the metadata is spread out into chunks, and to address this data, you have to go through a sort of like a page table, a two-layer table that will help us look for the cluster on the disk. So this is how a regular kubectl2 image looks like. You can see that we have a header, an L1 table that is hard-coded there, a reference counter for usage with snapshots, and snapshot headers for usage again with the snapshots, and then we have layer 2 tables and data in the zones where we keep our data, the chunks for our data. So let's look at how we actually do the addressing in a kubectl2 format. So let's say that we have a physical offset on the disk that we want to access. This comes, as I've explained before, from the guest image that only knows that it's using the disk, a regular disk. When this request comes down to us, we're going to be using the layer 1 table that we have defined here. And after that, we're going to be using a layer 2 table that we're going to be getting from the layer 1 table. And after that, this will enable us to find the cluster on the disk where the data is. And after that, we have to index in the cluster on the disk to find the actual useful data that we're going to be providing to the machine. And for snapshots, what you're going to have to do is that if the cluster you're looking for on your physical disk is not there, then you're going to have to look to the to the root disk or the base image, we call it, and you're going to have to do that as many times as needed. Each kcal2 disk can have a base image, and you're going to be going down the disk images until you find the root disk image. And you can do this many different ways. You have an example here with three overlay disk images, and here with other structures of overlay images. So let's talk about the bhyve in terms of bits. So I was how bhyve handles this the request that get from that come from the guest is that the requests come in a are enqueued in a structure that is called the IOVEC. So the IOVEC is basically a buffer and a length, and when doing IO for a specific request, you have an array of IOVECs that represent a contiguous space on the disk that is formed by from different buffers that are stored in different areas of memory. So this is called scatter-gather I/O, and the advantages of using scatter-gather I/O is that you have specific system calls for working with them. There, for example, pread v and pread v, and these system calls do I/O. This I/O is atomic, so you can do for each IOVEC that you have in your array of IOVECs, you can do a separate disk access, and you can do that in a multi-threaded fashion. So this means that you're actually going to, if you're using IOVECs instead of buffers that we usually use, you're going to see a speed increase. So that's how bhyve works. For adding kcal support, this way of organizing data has been a bit of an issue, because as I told you before, kcal is organized in clusters, and these clusters can be found anywhere in an IOVEC. Furthermore, they can even be split up into different IO vectors, and that is an issue, because I will not be able to use the same period v and pwrite v system calls for writing and reading from the disk with IOVEX, because I need to identify where on the disk I want this operation to happen. And this is an issue, because the speed increase comes from doing the I/O in parallel, but in this situation I will have to basically put all the IOVECs and look through all the IOVECs and see how where each cluster is located on the disk, and just after that I will either have to split it into IOVEX and do IOVEX, or do the work serial in a serial fashion. So that means I look for the first cluster, I do the read or the write, then the next cluster, and so on until I have finished the request. And this is the way of work that I've tried so far. I've done this because it's easier to handle and easier to debug at the moment, and I wanted to have a proof of concept of kcal2 actually working. So the drawback is clear that we're losing the atomicity of working with IOVEX, and we're losing the serialization aspect of the work. Serializing the work, and this will see that has an impact on performance. And for adding copy and write support, so basically snapshot support, what I have to do is that for each chunk in an IOVEC that I find, I will have to look if it's located in the current or the opened disk file or a base disk file, and I'll have to go and look for this chunk and see if I can find it. The issue with this approach is that it requires more lookups on disk. So this happens because the layer 2 that I've showed before, the layer 2 table that I've showed you before, is actually stored on disk. And when I do a lookup in it, I have to read it from the disk, and I do not have any caching mechanism implemented for caching these L2 tables. And we'll see that this will become an issue when working with copy on write files. So I've actually added the copy on write and qcow functionality in a libvdisk and used it and tested it in bhyve. So for testing, for evaluation, what I did is I ran bhyve on my machine, and I used the libvdisk with it, and I ran a Linux virtual machine from the qcow disk image, and I did stress tests and I also did speed tests for it. So, and let's look at the results. So the first result is actually me doing writes. Me doing a lot of writes on the disk. This is a write focus test, and I tried writing 512 megs, a gig, and 2 gigs to the disk. And we can see here that I did this test for the raw performance that is already implemented in bhyve, the qcow performance only of the qcow file, and the copy on write file. So this is a snapshot of the disk. And we can see that from going from raw to qcow, disk format has added basically it's doubled or tripled, doubled to tripled the time it takes for the write. That is because we have to do many more writes, many more reads from the disks. From the disk and writes to the disk, because we have to create new layer 2 tables, we have to add entries to these layer 2 tables, and this all adds many more IO operations that add more time to the write. And for the copy on write, as I've told you before, there's an even more added overhead because we have to check two different disk images in order to see if we have the chunk on the disk. If we don't, then we have to do the write, and this adds even more overhead. So this is a basic write test. The next issue is doing a more read intensive operation, and we can see that for on OS boot, I've booted. This is a test of how much time it takes for the Linux operating system to boot up. So for getting from the raw shut off virtual machine to a prompt, to a console prompt, and we can see that for a raw disk we have the 23 seconds, and the copy qcow has more, but not that much more, and the copy on write disk proves to be a bit faster when it comes to read operations, because it doesn't have to create new layer 2 tables, and that has proven to be a bit of a challenge. So because writes do more IO operations than reads. So finally, the current state of integrating qcow and libvdisk to bhyve is that I've added qcow to support with read, write, flush, trim, probe operations. I've added support for copy on write, so for actually using snapshots. I've also added a way for using the library in a multi-threaded fashion, because before you would have, if you weren't using synchronization primitives in your code, you'd actually have issues with multiple workers trying to access the same place on disk, and this would lead to synchronization issues. So I added some synchronization primitives, and I've also added a Python interface to libvdisk. I've done this in order for us to be able to write the unit tests for the library and for it to be able to be used by other people, for example, for building new tools that work with disks without connecting them to virtual machines. And the further work that I propose for this is I'm going to be pushing for libvdisk to be upstreamed and writing more code for it in order to be in the best shape for it to be upstreamed. Also, I'm working with a bachelor student now on adding VMDK support for QCow, for libvdisk. And as we've seen from the evaluation, this QCow implementation sorely lacks a caching mechanism. If we added a caching to QCow, we'd see a bit of a bump in speed, and it would be closer to the performance that QCow actually has on Kimu. And this basically is the work that I'm proposing for the future. I'd like to thank Matthew Grooms because he sponsored this work and he's been a lot of help with this. Marcelo Araujo for actually pointing me to this format and to libvdisk and show me what I'd have to do for it, and Darius Mihai and Elena Mihailescu because they helped me a lot with debugging and with moral support for working on this project. Thank you.
And we're back for questions and answers after that talk. Go ahead, I'll be back later.
Great. So let's get them in order. So first, John asks if, let me get the question right, if I thought about using range locks for the backing file. I didn't try using range locks, but that's a good idea to improve the performance for QCow and others. The next question. So plans on this hitting head. So I've been talking with Marcel Molinar, the author of VDSK, and now I'm in the process of discussing a way to push this in ahead, because what libvdsk should be committed, and then bhyve the changes to bhyve should be committed. So, and that's we'll have to figure out a way to do that. So the next question, I'm not familiar with fixed sizings. I do not know what those are. I'm sorry if you can clarify that in the questions. I'll come back with an answer. Double P, when I answered differing block pages, I meant that there's a difference between a block size and page size, because a page, the block size of a file system can differ depending on its implementation. So for example, for VMDK, the block sizes are actually 64K, something like that. So that's why I said there's a difference. And so I'm listening for the question, John. Reading the question. The block size for QCow is configurable from what I can remember. Yeah, so I read it from the for QCow and for VMDK, it's readable from the header. So you can change it, but I do not know if you'd want to do that. I mean, I've only seen the default size. Okay, so thank you very much for the questions. And if you have any more questions, I can answer them in the IRC chat as well.